Good morning, everyone. Bonjour a tous. It is a pleasure to be with you here today. Immigration is critical to the future of our country. How we manage it to ensure long-term sustainability is just as important. As an immigrant myself, I'm proud of Canada's history of welcoming newcomers who contribute to communities across the country. I'm equally invested in ensuring our system remains strong and robust for future generations. It is now my distinct honor to introduce Prime Minister of Canada, Justin Trudeau.
Thank you, Paul, for your words, and thank you for your hard work as Parliamentary Secretary on immigration. In a moment, Minister Miller will be detailing our immigration plan. Before he does, I want to say a few things. Canadians are justifiably proud of our immigration system. It has made our economy the envy of the world. It's how we've built strong, diverse communities. It's how we've demonstrated that differences can and must be a source of strength, not a source of weakness for communities and society. Immigration is vital to our future. And as a federal government, we have to make sure that that pride, that faith in immigration is not undermined. We've been through a hard time these past few years. COVID stopped everything. When we started to emerge from it, workers were in short supply, things we needed weren't going to market, and prices started going up. So we acted. We made sure that our businesses had workers. Our economy got moving again. We actually experienced the fastest jobs recovery after the pandemic in the G7. Now, it is time to make the adjustments to stabilize the immigration system that we need and get it working right for Canadians for right now. Today, we're announcing that we will reduce the number of immigrants we bring in over the next 3 years, which will result in a pause in the population growth over the next 2 years. This builds on our previously announced measures to cap international student permits and reform the temporary foreign worker program, all of which we are implementing with a single aim: stabilize our population growth to give all levels of government time to catch up, time to make the necessary investments in health care, in housing, in social services to accommodate more people in the future. Our immigration system has always been responsible and it has always been flexible. And so we are acting today. Because in the tumultuous times as we emerged from the pandemic, between addressing labour needs and maintaining population growth, we didn't get the balance quite right. With the plan we're announcing today, along with previously announced measures, we're making our immigration system work better. We need others to step up and do their part too. Far too many corporations have chosen to abuse our temporary measures, exploiting foreign workers while refusing to hire Canadians for a fair wage. All while under the watch of provinces, some colleges and universities are bringing in more international students than communities can accommodate, treating them as an expendable means to line their own pockets. That's unacceptable, and it needs to change. Businesses should no longer rely on cheap foreign labour. My message to them is that there is no better time to hire and invest in Canadian workers. Our international student cap is dealing with exploitative colleges and universities, but all institutions need to take it upon themselves to be more responsible. And every step of the way, we need provinces and territories to work closely with us, too. Immigration is essential for Canada's future, but it must be controlled and it must be sustainable. With today's annual immigration plan, that is precisely what we're doing. Thank you all for being here this morning.
Hi, everyone. Glad to be here with you in Ottawa on the traditional territory of the Algonquin people. I want to develop a little on what the Prime Minister just said. Indeed, immigration is indispensable, has been indispensable to the creation and the identity of this country, indispensable to its future. As mentioned in our recent history, it was key to increasing our gross domestic product, net entrance into the workforce, particularly coming out of COVID, even going into COVID. We had labor shortages, provinces clamoring for immigration measures to bring in more people, and we acted swiftly. Thanks to that, as the IMF has noted, we prevented a recession, and I think that's important to realize when we look at some of the measures today to stabilize the immigration system. When it comes to permanent immigration targets, this plan is probably the first of its kind so far as it integrates and responds to a lot of criticisms that we've received in the past. This plan that we table as a statutory matter on November 1st only talks about permanent residency. This plan this year gives a better snapshot for people to look at total population growth and the growth of temporary residents, as well as the measures that we're putting into place to reduce those populations over the next few years. When it comes to Canada's permanent immigration targets and aligning them to our economic needs, I'm here to announce and confirm that the current plan reduces next year's projections from 500,000 permanent residents to 395,000, a net reduction of 105,000 permanent residents immediately in 2025. After that, in 2026, a progression down to 380 to stabilize the numbers at 365 in 2027. The lower permanent resident targets, as well as the temporary resident targets that I will speak to in some length in the next few minutes, will have and are expected to impact the housing supply gap by about 670,000 units by the end of 2027. That means that we will not have to build an additional 670,000 housing units by that time. This is significant. Again, some structural aspects to this plan as well is the need to focus on people that are already here. It means that according and consistent with our plan, over 40% of permanent residents will come from the temporary residents that are already in Canada. These people are a young labour pool, they're skilled, they're here, they've begun their process of integration, and it doesn't place the additional demands on the housing, healthcare, and social services that we see with someone that comes directly from another country. It makes sense. We have a large pool. There are ways to integrate that highly talented pool into the permanent residency population. Adjustments will be made to our economic immigration streams to prioritize that transition of workers already here and focus on the labor and be responsive to the labor market needs. But for that, we need provinces to move forward and come forward with their data and tell us their needs. The federal government has an understanding of what those needs are. It is a sophisticated one, but it isn't the only voice in this, and provinces have a responsibility to come to us and tell us what those needs are. As I mentioned a little earlier, for the first time, the Immigration Levels Plan includes targets for temporary residents, such as international students, temporary foreign workers, the postgraduate work permits that comprise that. In the temporary residence space, over 50% of that is occupied by international students and postgraduate work permits. So the measures that we instituted a little less than a year ago are ones that are important to highlight the success of. We have seen, thanks to those measures, a reduction of about 43% in the number of new study permits accorded, and that's working. Studies are showing quite consistently that is contributing to the lowering of the rent, notably in Vancouver, Surrey, as well as Toronto, close to 8 to 10%. And this is something which is a clear proof point and in fact encourages us to take the measures that we are taking today with respect to permanent residency. The caps that we put in place are not measures that we took lightly, nor are the measures taken today ones that we're taking lightly without reflection. We are an open country, but not everyone can come to this country. Permanent residency is something that we hold dear. It has a value, as does Canadian citizenship. We've been a very generous country and will continue to do so. The numbers that we announce today roughly take us to a very ambitious plan that was put forward in about 2020. It reflects the fact that we have and we will continue to listen to Canadians. That's something that's important because the people standing behind me today are people that have been speaking to their constituents, have been speaking to economists, have been speaking to universities and institutions, and listening to their own families. And they've said consistently that while we are still and continue to be an open country, that volume that we have put forward is something that is of concern. And indeed, the latest Environics poll says as much. There are limits to governing by poll, and this is something that took some reflection over the last year. When I spoke to economists, they said clearly that their range of permanent residency needed to be reduced, but there wasn't unanimity as to what it was. It was about 350,000 to 450,000 for next year. This is somewhere in the middle, and I think it respects a responsible plan to grow immigration. Well, the net effect is a pause on the population growth. It is something that shows that we're listening to Canadians, shows that we have a controlled immigration plan that we can be proud of. One final point that I think is really important for the number crunchers out there, and I know there are indeed a few. The temporary measures that we have taken, including the ones that Minister Boissonneau has announced, are expected to result in a reduction of Canada's temporary resident population of 445,000 in 2025, an additional 445,000 in 2026, and perhaps a modest increase of 17 in 2027. Those are the numbers that we are factoring in as we look at the impact on the need to build housing units, but also the ones we look at when we look at the overall mix and the plan to reduce the temporary resident population from 7 to 5%. One final note on regularization, and I know this was an important mandate of our government. It has become quite clear over the last year that there is no consensus on a mass regularization program, despite the fact that people in Canada continue to be Canadian, except for everything but in name. When looking at this regularization program, we looked at the impact that this could have on deploying it in a short period of time and making sure that it is a success that makes sense and is fair for everyone. It doesn't mean we've left these people behind. We are prepared to institute a smaller program in number to make sure that we are targeting important aspects of the economy, whether it's construction or healthcare, to regularize some folks that, again, should be Canadian by right and aren't today. Those are measures that will continue, but in a much smaller amount than perhaps the mandate letter that I carry suggested. And that is something that we will continue to work on and continue to work with Canadians and the implicated organizations. We have a lot of challenges in this area. The consensus is one that was hard fought. It's something that we have to continue fighting for, and we will continue fighting for it. But today, with this plan, we're proposing a managed migration plan that puts control in the federal government over the numbers of people coming to this country and will contribute to a positive future for all Canadians and one where we can serve both immigrants and Canadians better. Thank you. Je vous remercie infiniment.